I now have the great privilege of speaking to Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, who is going to be speaking at Ignited by Truth on replacing the sexual state with the civilization of love. And she was so gracious as to be the first to interview and could do this with me on a Sunday. Well, welcome to Carolina Catholic, Dr. Morse.
Well, I'm glad to be here. I'm looking forward to being in North Carolina soon.
Oh, thanks. And I'm just so appreciative because we were supposed to do this tomorrow and I have a conflict. So anyway, Dr. Morse, what an interesting topic. I don't remember anybody talking about the sexual state Ignited by Truth. So this is very exciting for me.
Well, the sexual state, you've probably never heard anybody talk about the sexual state. As far as I know, I'm the only person who talks about it. And it's a concept that I kind of stumbled over in the course of dealing with various aspects of the sexual revolution. It just became clear to me that all of the different really terrible public policies and social practices that we see around us that we could associate with the term sexual revolution, pretty much all of it has come from the top down, generally explicitly using the power of the state, at least to get it started and sometimes to keep it rolling, you know. And so that's what the book that I wrote, which was with TAN Publications. Some of your people in North Carolina may know about TAN Books. I published that book in 2018, and the underlying theme of the book is being reinforced and proven every day, you know, that the state and the elite are creating the most toxic aspects of our sexual culture.
Well, let's talk a little bit about your background before we get into your book. I'll give everybody the title of the book as well as the topic that you're going to be talking about. You founded the Ruth Institute. So please just tell us a little bit about the Ruth Institute.
Yes, the Ruth Institute I founded in 2008 when I lived in San Diego. And when I founded it, I thought I was going to be talking with young college-age women about why they could get started with their families early and they didn't have to wait until they were 35 or near menopause, you know, to actually start their families. That's what I thought the Ruth Institute was going to be about. But it turned out that Proposition 8 intervened. Proposition 8, you may remember, was a California amendment that defined marriage as a union of one man and one woman. That originated in San Diego, where I was living at the time. I had literally just started the Ruth Institute. And I really didn't think I could sit it out and say, oh, this isn't my issue, I can't deal with this. Because I could see that if you redefine marriage, you're going to end up redefining parenthood. And if you redefine parenthood, you're going to weaken children's rights, socially and legally recognized rights to be in relationship with both of their parents. And I could just see nothing but trouble coming from that. So that's basically the Ruth Institute is an interfaith international coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. And we do everything focused on the kids. You know, we start with what is owed to children. And when you ask that question, what is owed to children, and you sort of reason backward from that, you know, we want to make sure kids have relationships with their parents. You know, when you work your way through the whole social system, what you end up with is, gosh, traditional Christian sexual morality, as taught by the Catholic Church, that's the system that is going to give the most people relationships with their parents throughout their whole childhoods. All these other things that we're doing are actively destructive of that very important need that children have. So that's the Ruth Institute in a nutshell right there, Judy.
Now, your doctorate is in economics, so this seems more like of a sociological topic. But tell us how you got into this, please.
Yeah, that's very true. That's very true. But I'll tell you the way it fits, okay, is that when you're an economist, you are trained to think in terms of two things. Number one, you think about incentives. And if you change incentive structures, you're going to change a lot of behavior all the way through society. And the second thing that economics teaches you to do is how to follow something throughout the whole of society, to see the system as a whole and not just, oh gosh, we changed the price of eggs to, you know, that how's that going to affect the chicken farmers? No, it's much farther than that, right? And so I was shocked, Judy, that when I was talking about Proposition 8 and why we really need to have man-woman marriage, no one, including economists, nobody wanted to say, gosh, we're changing the incentives, not just for gay people, we're changing incentives for a lot of people here. And number two, what are going to be the secondary effects and the effects further down the road? All we ever wanted to talk about was, oh, we're going to make gay people happy and we're going to make gay people comfortable. More gay people are going to get married. That's all anybody wanted to talk about. Nobody ever talked about the fact that you were going to have to rewrite the birth certificates, and which is exactly what happened. Of course, they had to take mother and father out of the birth certificates, husband and wife out of marriage law. That already happened. That happened long before the transgender movement came along, right? And that was a logical, necessary consequence of making marriage a gender-free institution. And I was talking about that. Nobody else wanted to talk about it, you know? So that's how economics appears. It's not the economic topic so much as the economic way of thinking that pointed me to the fact that, hey, we were taking much too narrow a view of what this thing was going to do if we really changed the definition of marriage across the board like this.
And you make an unbelievably interesting point in the part of the book. Now, so you're going to be talking about replacing the sexual state with the civilization of love, but your book is entitled The Sexual State, How Elite Ideologies Are Destroying Lives and Why the Church Was Right All Along, referring to the Catholic Church. It was so right. Interesting because even though I got married late and had my children late or whatever, and I'm one of the people that you're talking about in the book, interestingly enough, although I stayed home with my children and, you know, I made sure to do it because I went to law school to be able to stay home with my children, blah, blah, blah. But it was so interesting that you talked about how the last defender of the children are the mothers, and we're not doing our job.
Yeah, right. We're all at work. Right. We're all at work counting on somebody else to get it done. And the other part of it is, Judy, you and I are outliers in another way as well, which is that quite often the people who succeed in the managerial class, the women who succeed in the professions, whether it be law or journalism or medicine or any of those type of professions, they've done so by postponing childbearing. And you and I know that most of the people who postpone childbearing do not do it by living in a convent until they're 35. They do it by abortion and contraception. That's how they do it. And so, if you or I say, you know, gee, we really need to do something about the sexual revolution, a lot of those people are deeply committed to the sexual revolution, even if they can't articulate every aspect of it. Somehow they intuit that the lives that they have and their life as they know it, they can't imagine what it would be like if we didn't have, you know, all the things that we have that are supposedly so modern and wonderful and progressive and everything, right? And so the kind of person who succeeds in the professions tends to be drawn from the ranks of the person who's willing to not only put off childbearing, but to prioritize career over childbearing. It's not a hard and fast thing, because here we are, you and I both exceptions to that. But it's an incentive structure that has been put into place that reinforces itself, you see. And that's the kind of thing that I think has been woefully lacking in terms of analyzing where we are and why this thing is so entrenched, so difficult to get rid of, right? You can argue against it and win argument after argument. You can win all day long and still people aren't going to budge because they're psychologically and professionally committed in a way that your arguments don't really touch.
Plus, it's been enthroned in our society, much like when the Dobbs decision came down. People were like, wait a minute, I've had that right all my life and you're now taking it away from me. It's really going to be hard. I mean, I love your manifesto for the civilization of love. You have great ideas. I'm just wondering, are we going to buy into this as a society, and how do we overcome the enthronement of, you know, women's rights and all that kind of stuff, which we're now seeing with Dobbs? How do we convince women? Wait, you had a right that you really shouldn't have had in the first place.
Yeah, right. And it's caused a lot of problems that we're not willing to acknowledge. There are a lot of things I could say about that, but Judy, since you're a lawyer, let me start this way. And say, you know, you and I understand there's a difference between the Constitution and a legislature. The Constitution creates the basic rules of the game by which legislation is going to be made, right? And so you've got your structure, your legal structure, and all sorts of things happen underneath that. Well, there's a sexual constitution also. It's not written down anyplace. It never has been written down. But the sexual constitution tells everybody, these are the rules about when you're allowed to have sex, who you're allowed to have sex with, and when you're allowed to reproduce and have kids. What are the rules governing all that? And I think we can say that there was at one time a Christian sexual constitution. And we no longer have that Christian sexual constitution, which said basically you only have sex with the person you're married to. You don't have sex until you're married. You take care of your own kids. You leave other people's kids alone. You stay married unless somebody does something really terrible. You know, but there's a basic and you're supposed to take care of your own kids, right? Husband and wife, both are supposed to do that. And now we've replaced that constitution with a sexual revolutionary constitution, which basically says adults get to do whatever they want sexually. The purpose of the government is to make your sex life as convenient as possible. And kids more or less have to take whatever their parents choose to give them. That's the new constitution, you know. And we lost the Christian sexual. Does that make sense? The rules of the game?
Perfect sense.
Yeah. So what's happened to us, I think, is that we lost the Christian sexual constitution piecemeal. Because if somebody had announced in 1965, hey, this is what we want, everybody would have laughed them off the stage. Nobody would have gone along with it, right? It's always needed a certain amount of stealth, you know, and duplicity in order to get forward. So we lost it piecemeal, but I don't really think we're going to get it back piecemeal. But we have to fight it piecemeal. And so I view my role and the role of the Ruth Institute as being to say, look, here is where we need to go, and whatever piecemeal steps we take, whatever baby steps we take, whatever opportunities present themselves, we have to keep our eye on the ball. Our eye on the ball is that sex is about love, and it's not about my feelings. It's about life-giving, self-giving love, and it's fundamentally about procreation. You cannot factor out procreation, and that the Christian sexual system, the sexual constitution, gives children access to their parents more reliably than any other system anybody's ever devised. That's the truth of the thing. And if we can keep our eye on that, maybe, just maybe, people will find that appealing enough to say, you know what, I'm going to chuck this nonsense I've been doing all these years. I'm going to let it go. Because that happens. You know, Judy, it happens. I see those people all the time. They end up on my doorstep, oddly enough. As you may imagine, you know. But that they figure out, you know, I've been sold a bill of goods. This isn't working as it was promised. And I'm ready to stop messing around and go whole hog for the whole thing. So that's what I'm going to say when I get to North Carolina. I hope people over there enjoy it and are uplifted by it. And I'll be bringing my books to sell and a number of other resources that people can use to defend themselves and their family.
Well, we've been talking to Dr. Morse, who's going to be speaking at the 2023 Ignited by Truth on Saturday, April 29th. I can't wait. I'm going to have a whole cheering section for Dr. Morse. Absolutely. Because so many women, you're literally singing our song here. I mean, I'm very involved in the pro-life movement, and this all ties into why we abort our children. We're destroying generations of children. And I'm so excited and so grateful that you're willing to give me an interview on a Sunday. I know it's a day of rest, but this was so much fun. I would love to have this conversation with all my girlfriends just sitting around you.
Well, I hope that we can do that I can be on your show another time. And one last thing I'd like to add about the conference, Judy, is that if you have people who are listening now, if you have friends or family members who are either not Catholic or who are lapsed Catholics, bring them along. Bring them. You know, I want to talk to them, because I think the church's message, my position is the reason the Ruth Institute is an interfaith organization is because the church's teaching is universal. It works for everybody. It applies to everybody. I have non-Catholics on my staff. Some of them will be there helping me table, as a matter of fact. And my position is, by golly, the church's teaching is so good, we have no right to keep it to ourselves. We need to be talking about it. And so I welcome people to bring their non-Catholic friends, your lapsed Catholic friends. Come on. Come on. I'm ready to talk to you.
The whole thing was Ignited by Truth. You should come and get ignited. Well, Dr. Ruth, Dr. Morse, I think you can ignite everybody all by yourself.
Well, I'm looking forward to it.
Well, God bless you. And thank you for taking my call on a Sunday. I appreciate it. God bless you.